Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never. Worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before, bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul. Worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like this. Worship your holy name. Bless you, Lord. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship your holy name. Come on. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship his holy. Yes, I will worship your holy name. Lord, I worship your holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul. Worship your heart. worship your
Good morning, everyone, and kind of welcome you all this morning on this beautiful day to our worship service this morning. As you can see, we have a visiting speaker in our pulpit. We have James Burke with us this morning. No stranger, James has been with us this morning, and we welcome James back. James has been accepted to Union College and will go on to study and do his studies in ministry. And with that, we wish him all the very best, and I'm sure you will remember him in your prayers as well. Obviously, Andy's on holidays, and if you need the services of a minister or any pastoral care for any reason whatsoever, you can approach any of the elders, and that can be done on your behalf. It is with a small measure of sadness that we have to announce that it's the last, possibly the last, foursome Sunday amongst us. And we really are going to miss you. And we want you to know that our best wishes go with you from this day forward to wherever you go and whatever you find yourselves doing. We wish you God's richest blessings from this congregation and every member of it. Thank you for all you have done. Okay, James.
Thank you. It's very good to be back with you all again. It's so good to be invited back. Let's come before God and worship him. It says in Deuteronomy 4:30-31, when you're in distress and all these things have happened to you, then in later days you will return to the Lord your God and obey him. For the Lord your God is a merciful God. He will not abandon or destroy you or forget the covenant with your ancestors, which you confirmed to them by oath. We're going to sing Blessed Assurance, if you'd like to stand. Let's come to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, We still our hearts before you this morning. Lord, we have come to you this morning to worship you. And Lord, let us do so. Lord, fill us with grace and mercy to see you in your word. Lord God, when we look into your word, you are revealed to us. You are the majestic God, greater than any of us or anybody in this world could ever comprehend. And yet you are a God of grace and mercy as you stoop down to communicate to us. You are the God who speaks and speaks in a language that we can understand. Lord, we don't deserve this. We don't deserve to understand the loveliness and the brilliance of a good God. But yet, you are pleased to show us who you are. So Lord, as we come before you, may we not take it for granted that we are reading the very word of God, but may we revel in the reality of it. Lord Jesus, be with us this morning. And Holy Spirit, lift us up into the heavenly places where Christ dwells, so that we might see him in all his glory and excellence. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to read our assurance of pardon now. It's found in Romans 5, 1-2. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. Amen. We're going to have our lectionary scripture reading, which is going to be read by Noel. So we'd like to invite Noel up.
So our lectionary reading this morning, we continue on in the book of Samuel, 1 Samuel. So you'll find that on page 284 of our pew Bibles, I believe. And we we commence at verse 1. One day, Jonathan, son of Saul, said to his young armor bearer, "Come, let's go over to the Philistine outpost on the other side." But he did not tell his father. Saul was staying on the outskirts of Gibeah, under a pomegranate tree in Migron, where with him there were 600 men, among whom was Ahijah, who was wearing an ephod. He was the son of Ichabod's brother, Ahitub, son of Phinehas, the son of Eli, the Lord's priest in Shiloh. No one was aware that Jonathan had left. On each side of the path that Jonathan had intended to cross to reach the Philistine outpost was a cliff. One was called Bezos and the other called Sina. One cliff stood to the north toward Michmash and the other to the south toward Geba. Jonathan said to his young armor bearer, "Come, let's go over to the outpost of those uncircumcised men. Perhaps the Lord will act in our behalf. Nothing can hinder the Lord from saving, whether by many or by few." "Do all you have in mind," his armor bearer said. "Go ahead, I am with you in heart and soul." Jonathan said, "Come on, then we will cross over towards them and let us see if they will what they will say to us. Wait there until we come to you. We will stay there where we are and not go up to them. But if they say, 'Come to us,' and we will climb up, because that will be our sign to the Lord. He has given them into our hands." So both of them showed themselves to the Philistine outpost. Look, said the Philistines, the Hebrews are crawling out of the holes they were hiding in. The men of the outpost shouted to Jonathan and his armor-bearer, come up to us and we'll teach you a lesson. So Jonathan said to his armor-bearer, climb up after me. The Lord has given them into the hand of Israel. Jonathan climbed up using his hands and feet with his armor-bearer right behind him. The Philistines fell before Jonathan and his armor-bearer followed and killed behind him. In the first attack, Jonathan and his armor-bearer killed 20 men in an area of about half an acre. And then panic struck the whole army, those in the camp and field and those in the outposts and raiding parties, and the ground shook. And it was a terrible panic sent by God. Amen.
So, boys and girls, I have an offer of sweets to you. So if you'd like to come to the front, I'll come down as well. That was my drawing. And there's the proof. Okay. So, I have come this morning to make a covenant. Okay, so what's a covenant? A covenant is a promise that's based on a condition. So the best way to explain that is to actually make one. So we're gonna make a covenant this morning. What's your name?
Noah.
Noah. Well, me and Noah, we're hopefully gonna make a covenant this morning. Okay. So the covenant, it usually starts with a bit of history. So I'll talk about what I've done, then I'll lay out what's going to happen, and then we're going to high five, okay? So, a bit of history. My name is James, and I've come from Rathfarnham, the far land of Rathfarnham this morning, to come and make a covenant with Noah. And this is the covenant. I am going to promise you two sweets if you do everything I say. Do you think you can do it? Okay, do you want a high five on it? High five. Yeah, nice. Okay, so now we're in a covenant, and you have to do everything I say. Okay, if you want to stand up and do a spin. Nice. You take a step this here way, another step this way, and a step backwards. A step forwards, and now I want you to do 10 spins in 2 seconds, starting from 1, 2, stop. Did you get it?
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know if you did. Do you want to sit back in your seat? No. I think you only got 3 spins in 2 seconds there. So you've broken the covenant with me. What? And I can't give you these sweets anymore. So, well, what if I couldn't bring in this morning, but if I had a friend, the Olympian, I don't have a friend and an Olympian, but if I brought in an Olympian gymnast and he said, well, I can do 10 spins in 2 seconds and I'm going to do it on behalf of Noah. I'm going to do it for Noah. And so I say, well, okay, because I've initiated the covenant, I say, well, okay, I'll give you the sweets if you can do the 10 spins in 2 seconds.
Okay.
And the gymnast, he says, well, if I do the 10 spins in 2 seconds, I'll give the sweets to Noah. So do you trust him?
Mm-hmm.
You do? Good, good. So he comes in and he does the 10 spins in 2 seconds, and I give him the sweets. And he gives the sweets to you. In fact, he gives 3 sweets to you, because it's better. It's better. Yeah. So, well, that's a bit like what Jesus does for us. We have been entered in with a covenant with God, where we have to do everything God says all the time. We have to do everything God says perfectly. But we don't, do we? We've broken the covenant with God. But Jesus, he comes in and he says, well, I can obey God perfectly, and I'm going to do it on your behalf, on our behalf. So Jesus comes in and he does all of what God asks, all that we couldn't do. He does all that God asks and he gets the reward. But he doesn't keep the reward to himself, but he shares the reward to all of us if we trust him. And so that's a bit what like Jesus done, what the Olympian done. It's a bit like what Jesus done. And I think, what should that leave us with? What should that leave us thinking? I think it should just leave us in awe at what Jesus done. Jesus went to the cross for us. He obeyed God perfectly. And he did, and he rose from the grave, all for us. And so I think we should be left thinking, what a great Savior is Jesus. And so as we leave this morning, may we keep that with us, thinking about the goodness of Jesus. Great. Thank you very much, Noah. You're a great help. Enjoy those sweets. We're going to sing, Jesus, I Will Come to You, if you'd like to stand. So the passage I'll be speaking on this morning is Genesis 15. We're going to read the whole chapter. And if you have your Bibles in front of you, it would be helpful if you open it, but it'll be up on the screen as well. So Genesis 15, the late R.C. Sproul, my favourite Bible teacher, he once said that if he were put into solitary confinement and he could only take one chapter of the Bible with him, he would take Genesis 15. And if he could only take one verse in the entirety of the Bible, it would be Genesis 15, verse 17. And this chapter in the Bible is a very key part of the unfolding story, the unfolding plan of God to save us. So with this in mind, let's read it. After this, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your very great reward. But Abram said, "Sovereign Lord, what can you give me, since I remain childless, and the one who will inherit my estate is Eliezer of Damascus?" And Abram said, "You have given me no children, so a servant in my household will be my heir." Then the word of the Lord came to him, "This man will not be your heir, but a son who is your own flesh and blood will be your heir." He took him outside and said, "Look up at the sky and count the stars, if indeed you can count them." Then he said to him, "So shall your offspring be." Abram believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness. He also said to him, "I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to take possession of it." But Abram said, "Sovereign Lord, how can I know where I will gain possession of it?" So the Lord said to him, "Bring me a heifer, a goat, and a ram, each 3 years old, along with a dove and a young pigeon." Abram brought all these to him, cut them in two, and arranged the halves opposite each other. The birds, however, he did not cut in half. Then the birds of prey came down on the carcasses, but Abram drove them away. As the sun was setting, Abram fell into a deep sleep, and a thick and dreadful darkness came over him. Then the Lord said to him, "Know for certain that for 400 years your descendants will be strangers in a country not their own, and they will be enslaved and mistreated there. But I will punish the nation they serve as slaves, and afterward they will come out with great possessions. You, however, will go to your ancestors in peace and be buried at a good old age. In the fourth generation, your descendants will come back here, for the sin of the Amorites has not yet reached its full measure." When the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoking firepot with a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces. On the day the Lord made a covenant with Abram and said, "To your descendants I give this land from the Wadi of Egypt to the river, the great river, the Euphrates, the land of the Kenites, Kenizzites, Kadmonites, Hittites, Perizzites, Raphaites, Amorites, Canaanites, Girgashites, and Jebusites." This is God's word. Let's come to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word, and may you open it up to us, God, so that we might understand it and that we might see you in it, and so that we might apply it to our everyday lives. Because of all of the Bible, the entirety of Scripture speaks to us. So do that for us this morning. Do it for us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Back when I was younger, I had a friend called Ryan, and me and Ryan were great friends. I trusted Ryan he trusted him unwavering, really, sometimes stupidly. Everything Ryan said, I took as gospel, I took as truth. And he loved these books. He used to read long lists of facts, these fact books that had long lists of random facts, and he would say these facts to me, and I would be, "Wow, how do you know all this stuff? This is incredible." And so I would just absorb all this, and I would spew it out to my family when I get home, telling all these facts. I would say, well, Ryan said, and I can remember I said that phrase so much, I started to contradict my parents a lot. I would say, "Oh no, but Ryan said this." And they would say, "Well, you know, not everything Ryan says is true." But I trusted him unwaveringly. I said the phrase, "But Ryan said," so much. I think it became a bit of a family joke, a household joke, and my sister still hold to that today. They actually brought it up the other day unexpectedly, so the memory still hasn't died. But me and Ryan, we were great friends. And I can remember one day we made a covenant with each other. We wanted to cement our loyalty to one another with a handshake. But it wasn't any ordinary handshake. It was a blood brother handshake. You make a small incision in your palm, and Ryan makes a small incision in his palm, and we shake on it. And we're saying, I am going to be loyal to you for the rest of my life. I'm going to be loyal to you forever. That was the covenant, really. But as time went on, me and Ryan started to drift apart. I fell into a different friendship group, and he fell into a different friendship group, and we started to kind of distance ourselves from one another. And now, since, you know, I moved home a good few years ago, and I think it's probably been about close to a decade since I talked to Ryan last. He'd probably be shocked that I'm even mentioning him. So me and Ryan, we broke our covenant that we made to one another. We weren't loyal to each other. We forgot the covenant. And well, in the passage I'm speaking on today, God makes a covenant with Abram. And this is a covenant that could not be broken because it was based and fulfilled by the unchanging God who is utterly trustworthy. And, you know, I talked about R.C. Sproul earlier, saying this is his favorite chapter, and this, and verse 17 is the chapter he take with him to solitary confinement. Let me just read verse 17 again. When the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoking firepot with a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces. One verse in the entirety of Scripture, and that's it, really? It's such a strange verse to us. It's not a well-known verse. But my aim this morning is to show just how glorious this verse is when it's said in its context. Of course, I'll fail at that because how could I show how glorious this verse is? But if I could show in just some capacity the wonder of this verse, then I think we'll be better off for it. So much in Genesis 15 will only really be scratching the surface, but it begins by saying, after this, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your very great reward. So instinctively, we should go back and see what happened before this in Genesis. Well, in Genesis 12, Abram was called by God to leave his homeland and go out to a land which God had promised him and to his offspring. And so Abram left, and God also promised that Abram's family would be a blessing to the world. So Abram left to the land of Canaan, which was the land that he was going to give to him and his offspring. But in chapter 14, war breaks out in the surrounding nations. And Abram's nephew Lot has been entangled in this war because he's settled in a place near Canaan called Sodom. And Sodom was entangled in this war, and they were plundered and sieged, and all of the possessions and the people of Sodom were taken out and put in the surrounding nation, the enemy territory. So Abram gets word of this, and he sends out his military to go and rescue Lot. And so he does so, he rescues Lot, and he receives all of the plunder from the war and all the people from Sodom as well. And he takes them back. And the king of Sodom, he approaches, and he wants to negotiate a deal with Abram. He says, well, in exchange for the people, you can keep all the possessions. But Abram, he refuses the deal. He gives the king of Sodom back the people and the possessions because he wanted the surrounding nations. He wanted the nations to know that it was God alone who made him great. It was God alone who made him, who gave him this wealth. And so after the war, Abram's left anxious. He's left vulnerable, and potentially there's another attack going to happen. But the Lord, in verse 1 of chapter 15, says to him, Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your very great reward. So God is both Abram's shield and his reward. In this anxious moment of not knowing what will happen, God speaks. He comforts Abram and he says, do not be afraid, Abram. And why should Abram not be afraid? Because God is his protector, his shield. But not only that, but God is his reward. God is saying, you know, the riches of Sodom, they will cease, they will pass. But I am your reward, Abram. Enjoy me, be satisfied in me. And surely that's the heart of Christianity, isn't it? To be satisfied in God, to enjoy God by knowing him. And that's the only path to lasting peace and happiness. But Abram, he seems to overlook this. He has a burning complaint to make to God. He knows that God has given him this great wealth, all he could ever need, except he lacks one thing. He lacks a child, a son, to inherit all of this wealth, to inherit all that God has given him. And so, you know, God has promised him this also. He's promised him this in previous chapters, to have a son, but he's still not acting on this promise. So he boldly says to God in verse 2 and 3, Sovereign Lord, and this is a title of respect, shows that this complaint is coming from a place of faith. He says, Sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless and the one who will inherit my estate is Eliezer of Damascus? God, you've promised me this, and yet my wife, she's still barren. The Lord doesn't reprimand Abram for this complaint, but he listens and he answers him. This man will not be your heir, he says, but a son who is your own flesh and blood will be your heir. And God reaffirms the promise he made to Abram, and he does so powerfully in verse 5. He took him outside and said, Look up at the sky and count the stars, if indeed you can count them. Then he said to him, So shall your offspring be. I remember one day when I was younger looking up at the massive expanse in the sky on a clear night and seeing all of the stars and attempting to count them. We go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Where was I again? 1, 2, 3. It's pointless. It's pointless. Billions of stars on display. Who could number them? And so God says, so will your offspring be. And Abraham, looking up in wonder at the grace of God, believes him. He trusts God that he will fulfill his word, his promise. And I'm sure that every time Abraham looked up at the massive expanse on a clear night, he was reminded of God's promise to him, the promise of offspring. In verse 6, it says, Abram believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness. That's such a key verse in the Bible, isn't it? Such a key verse. God counted his faith as righteousness. Now, that didn't mean that Abram was actually righteous. We know that he sinned in the past, and we know that he'll sin in future chapters of Genesis. But he takes this trust. God takes this trust, this childlike dependence on him, and he credits it to Abram as righteousness. Abram is counted as righteous because of his faith in God's promise. The Apostle Paul uses this verse to explain what we call the doctrine of justification by faith, that we are not saved by our works, but that we are saved by faith alone in Christ, the Son of God. This is Romans 4:24-25. The words it was credited to him were written not for him alone, but also for us, to whom God will credit righteousness. For us who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, He was delivered over to death for our sins and was raised to life for our justification. You know, those who believe in Jesus, they are children of Abraham. Abraham, not physically, but they're children of Abraham by faith. How is this the case? Well, Jesus, he was a descendant of Abraham. He was the promised descendant of Abraham. And by faith, we have been united to Jesus. And so we are children of Abraham by faith. And this righteousness that was given to Abraham is the exact same righteousness that is given to us. God counted this righteousness to Abraham because of his faith in the promise of a son. And God counts our righteousness, counts us as righteous by faith in the promise of a son also. And that son is Jesus, and it's Jesus' righteousness that we have been counted with. And it was Jesus' righteousness that Abraham was counted with. And so, in the entirety of history, all of the praise and glory is centrally located in Jesus Christ. All of history sings to the praise of the Son, Jesus. But what's this righteousness for? Why do we need it? And why did Abraham need it? God has not yet finished reaffirming the promises he made to Abraham, for he reminds him of the promise of the land. He reminds Abraham that he and his offspring will be given this land, and that this righteousness that he's been credited with, it qualifies Abraham to receive the land. This is true of Abraham, and it is true for us. Christ's righteousness that he gives to us is what qualifies us to receive the promised land also. It's what qualifies us to enter into heaven. This righteousness is the token, you could say, into the promised land. There is no other token into the promised land other than the righteousness of Jesus. But this free gift of righteousness and a free entrance into the eternal promised land, this token into paradise, can it be broken? Can it be cut in half? Can we destroy it? Can we taint it with our sin? Will it wear away? Can we lose it? Or a question might be, how can we even know that we've obtained it? Some of us here today may be thinking, how can I know that I am a Christian? How can I know that I'm saved? I think all Christians have thoughts like these from time to time. We all have seasons of sin and distraction, where we have seasons where we can think, how can God love me? We have seasons where it seems like the joy of the Christian life has been sucked up into a black hole of disappointment or of regret or by grief, by apathy or by anxiety. You know, when all seems so dark and God seems so distant, what do we have to cling on to? This is in the same vein as Abraham's question in verse 8. Sovereign Lord, how can I know that I will gain possession of it? When the road gets bumpy, how will I know that I still have possession of it? When somebody buys land or buys a house, they should own the title deeds to that land. All the paperwork has been filled, and now the exciting part is that they get the keys to the house. Well, here is God filling out the paperwork and signing Abraham's name onto the deed. God answers Abraham's question by making a covenant with him. He says, right here, right now, Abraham, you want to know, you'll gain possession of it. Well, let's make a covenant. God responds to Abraham with a shopping list. Bring me a heifer, a goat, a ram, each 3 years old, along with a dove and a young pigeon. And we're all thinking, this is really random. What's going on? But Abraham, he doesn't see it as random. He knows exactly what's going on. So he gets it. He gets the heifer, the goat, the ram, the dove, the pigeon. And he cuts each in half. He cuts each in half, except for the birds, and lays it on top of each other, one on top of each other, in two lines. And so in the middle, there is a big pool of blood. In the middle, there's a pool of blood spilling out of the carcasses. And Abraham waits. God initiates the covenant. And so all Abraham can do is wait. And he waits. And he waits. And now birds are coming down. And they're picking at the carcasses, trying to pluck away the symbolism of the covenant. And Abraham's shooing them away, trying to protect the covenant. And he continues to wait. And the sun is setting, it's getting dark, and God's still not acted. And then he falls into a deep sleep. And it says in this sleep that the darkness is thick. It's thick, it's a thick darkness. Abraham's in the presence of a holy God. And out of this darkness, God speaks. God says to Abraham, your offspring will suffer as slaves under another nation. We know that this nation is Egypt. But he promised Abraham that when the time is exactly right, when the time is perfectly right, he will deliver these people from the promise or from Egypt, and he will bring them to the promised land, and they will take possession of it when the time is exactly right. He's giving over the keys to the promised land. But God goes even further. His word is sufficient and it's trustworthy, but he goes even further. He goes a step further. He wants to show Abraham concretely what he means when he says he'll be faithful to this covenant. And here we are at verse 17. This entire sermon has just been laying the context for verse 17. Let's read it again. When the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoking fire pot with a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces. God doesn't write out covenants, but he cuts them. He cuts out treaties. He cuts out agreements. And this covenant, these carcasses on the ground that have been cut in half, they resemble what will happen if either of the parties go against the covenant. They would be cut in half. They would be killed. And in a normal covenant, that both the parties walk through. But in this covenant, it's not the case. It's a smoking fire pot and a blazing torch that passes between the pieces. Well, how is God represented in the Old Testament? Well, he's the consuming fire. He's the burning bush. He's the flaming torch by day and the pillar of cloud by night. This is God that's passing between the pieces. This is a visible representation of the invisible God. This is God who's passing through the pieces. And so he's effectively saying, may I be as these carcasses on the ground if I go against the covenant, if I forsake the covenant, if I break the covenant, if I forget the covenant, may I be as these pieces on the ground. God is putting his deity on the line here. He's putting his eternality on the line. He's putting his unchangeability on the line. He's willing to say, if I break this covenant, then may I undergo this mutation. May I die. Well, friends, can God die? No, he can't die. The eternal God cannot die. Can God undergo any change? He cannot undergo any change. He is unchanging from all eternity. Can God be cut in half? He is the indivisible God. He is spirit. He cannot be cut in half. And so what's God saying here? God is saying, I will surely be faithful to this covenant I've made with you. And you bet that he did. He fulfilled this promise, and he was faithful to it. You know, God, he cannot lie. He cannot cease to be trustworthy. And the same is true for us. As Christ's promises are true, God has offered us, who trust him, eternal life because of what Jesus has done for us. And when we have these seasons of dwindling faith, when the sun is setting and we're plunged into darkness, when all is dark and God seems so distant, what is there to assure us of salvation? What is there to assure us that indeed God has not forgotten us? God has not forsaken us. What is there to remind us that we have been forgiven? The answer is communion, actually. It's participating in the sacrament of communion. That is the seal of the new covenant. It says, each time we take communion, we're remembering Christ's death for us. This is my body broken for you. This is my blood poured out for you. And here's what the new covenant says. It says, for I will forgive their wickedness. That's us. Wickedness. I will forgive their wickedness, and I will remember their sins no more. I think we've somewhat lost the grandeur of communion today. I know that's certainly true for me. Let's regain it. Let's delight in it. It's good, and it reminds us of God's faithfulness to his promises. It reminds us that this covenant has been completed by Jesus, and it's been completed on our behalf. So do you lack assurance today? What about today when we're not taking communion? What is there to remind us of God's love, of God's unceasing love? Or are you thinking to yourself, how could God really love me? How could God forgive me? And look to Jesus. See him born of a virgin. See him live in perfect obedience and harmony of God's will. See him carry the cross to Calvary. And see him nailed upon the cross. See him cry out, it is finished, in victory. See him bow his head and taken from the cross. See him buried in a tomb for 3 days. And see him on the third day rise from that tomb. See him rise and then ascend into heaven to reign forever. And he did it for us. He did it for you. So do you lack assurance today? Well, look to Jesus and see what he's done for you. You know, praise God that he is indeed faithful to his promises. And praise God that he is our eternal reward, that we are to enjoy God for all of eternity, forever and ever, unceasing love, unceasing joy, unceasing peace, as we're in the immediate presence of our Savior. So what is there to remind us of? Or what is there? What can we cling on to? Well, it's God's promises that he's laid out in his word. And when we look into those promises, we see that it's not really that we're clinging on to God's promises, but that he's clinging on to us. That's the reality of it. So praise God. Let's close in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are indeed faithful to your promises. You're faithful to your covenants. Lord, thank you for sending Jesus to die for us and to live for us and to be raised from the grave for us. For we follow him. And we not only follow him, but he lives in us by his Spirit. And what happens to him, what happened to him, will happen to us. For we share in his reward. And his reward was to be raised to eternal life. And to be seated as a king. A king that would enjoy God for the rest of his days. And so God, we revel in the reality that our destiny is the same if we believe in Jesus. And so God, if there are anybody who do not yet trust Jesus as their Savior and Lord, may they tread carefully and think of this gift. And may they see Jesus. And Lord, for any who are seemingly dwindling in their faith, reassure us, O God, of your promises. Reassure us of your faithfulness. You have proved yourself over and over, God. And we have nothing to fear. So God, enable us to live life in full assurance and hope of our final destiny. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to close by singing May the Mind of Christ, My Savior. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all forevermore. Amen.